I mean, we were all in school at the same time. We all graduated at the same time. It's kind of just the concept of how this is my take on it. So the concept is basically how when you're studying and like working in a close proximity to other people, how I think your work gets influenced by them when you're not trying to, like, it's not on purpose necessarily. It's not that you necessarily start copying one another, but it influences your conversation. And it's also just kind of nice. I mean, I don't know if any of you guys are familiar with like how UNC has their master's program set up. You essentially share a larger space, but then you have individual studio spaces as well, which is nice because you have this communal aspect, but you can also literally like shut your door to the outside world and just like live in your world whenever you want, which is really nice. But like, it's also nice to sit there and kind of like come out of that world every now and then and like go ask opinions and like try to have conversations with other people. I mean, you can't create a bubble necessarily, if that makes sense. And yeah, I mean, I have to admit, I think I'm fortunate to like have studied with the people who are in the show, because like I know, especially with like the people who are here, like we had conversations like at least weekly about like what we were working on, what we were using. You know, and it's just kind of nice, like. Yeah, it's essentially just about like, I guess, the phenomenon of like studying with people for like an extended period of time too, because the program is 3 years. Mm-hmm. And so you do like, to a point, see these people almost every single day for like 9 to 10 months out of the year for 3 years. And yeah, it's just kind of about the idea of having this like communal aspect.
Mm-hmm.
I feel special. Well, I mean, I have to admit, like, I think it's also just this, like, as soon as you're done with that, like, you just kind of all go off in your own worlds. Like, even though I think we all technically still live in Detroit or, like, in, like, maybe not Detroit proper, but, like, the surrounding areas. But like we also haven't seen each other in a while. And I have to admit, I think it's interesting seeing like some people's newer work and seeing like what has happened since graduation. And what we've maybe continued working on or what we started working on, because I mean when you're in school you also can't technically work on every idea that you have. Like sometimes you have to put some things aside. So it's been interesting seeing like hearing the conversations while we're in school and now seeing like that's coming to fruition now. Like and seeing where that's going. So yeah, it's kind of the idea of like, yeah, having that communal aspect for such an extended period of time and then that in a way like completely disappearing and seeing if that's still influencing our work. If that makes sense. If not.
There's definitely like an intimacy. You're in such a close environment with people. I think we all kind of experience that, you know, at a workplace or anything else. You get to know people. And it's a very privileged position to be in. You get to have, if you have a good cohort, just so everyone knows, it's not guaranteed you have a good graduate cohort that you're with. And when you get a special community, whether it's a studio environment or that's outside the house, or you get the benefit of being in a program or people get along. All very, very different, but it's a very privileged position to be in. I mean, you get to have an insight into what you're talking about, an inside look on how somebody, you know, starts to work through a creative process. It's just a really beneficial thing. You have a lot of different scope on not only your work, but how someone works through problems. And then when you're outside of that, it's kind of a bittersweet moment. You no longer have this community of very supportive people that I'm sure you all know that people that have. So now you remember what they said, what they talked about, and you try to implement that in your own studio work. I know that peers would be outside, would be, you know, impressed by it or proud of that, anyone who's trying to better yourself. And so having these great positive people who I look up to as professionals was such, you know, an instrumental part of my career and actually. So hopefully that's the same for everybody else, but definitely that's what I took away from this.
Can you guys hear him? Is this thing back here? Okay, let me. Sorry. It got up really loud.
It's amazing, by the way. Can you see this?
And it was a surprise. So, being like working so closely together and seeing people's work and it happening, you know, kind of in real time. Being away from that for a couple of years and coming back and seeing what happened in the last little bit was really fun.
Yeah, I would definitely agree. It was a really thrilling part. I was like, what's everyone doing?
Yeah.
And like, it was a really nice surprise for I think all of us.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's do like a few, like a little bit about yourselves and you just kind of go down the line.
So I'm Kyle Sharkey. I got my undergraduate degree at Kim College of Art and Design, Grand Rapids, in drawing and painting. And then I came here to Detroit to go to WSU for the grad program. I majored in drawing and painting, so I really like drawing and painting. My work in general right now is focusing on art and skepticism, or skepticism in general. So why do we believe the things we believe? Questioning the dynamic of certain belief systems that we hold to be true, and whether or not they're biased or unbiased. And so I'm someone who's a proponent of trying to question certain beliefs or things that have been reiterated throughout art and art history. So particular things that are deemed as supernatural or otherworldly, I like to question those things, I like to bring those themes into allegories or narratives and see if they can be explained either by science or skepticism or reason. And so I've kind of taken that particular path.
Has that always been your focus?
I think in a way it's one of those weird things when you're creating a body of work over the course of years. I think my favorite quote by Rothko was when someone asked him, how many years is it, like, how long does it take for the make a painting? He said 50 years. Mm-hmm. And so it's a culmination of a lot of different elements. And so I think the best thing that an artist can do is try to investigate something, or at least for me it was. So I like to investigate. Mm-hmm. I like to have something to unravel and tackle. And for me as a creative person, that was instrumental. So involving myself in science and skepticism and modes of reason and logic and philosophy was something that promoted me to make more work outside grad. Because no one tells you what you should do when you're outside of that context. And so you have to figure out, how do I make work just to make work? And so that, I think, has always been an interest for me, and then I finally was able to say, why don't I just do that? Why don't I just take those two things and do that?
So you work a little bit in like all media, right?
Yeah.
And one of the interesting things with Kyle's work is that he uses the linoleum flooring for canvas. And you brought that in, I was very impressed. This is such a great use for the material. So can you talk a little bit about your process or how you came to like start using it?
Yeah, so anytime that I use a different material, like this is probably true for you guys as well. I mean, there's a lot of thought behind, you know, what you should use. And not only for, you know, when you're making work, how art, right? What is it? Mm-hmm. And so when you show up, you know, galleries in your guys' position, you know, yeah. Well, this actually still works and functions, it's right. Not going to fall apart. But also what supports, I think, a studio practice is very important. So there are certain elements and materials that are not conducive, I think, to the individual. I'm like, what is going to help you be create a productive studio environment? I think this is true in a lot of art. So, like, if you you know are using canvas and you're working in a small studio, you're like, But how do you still make really, if your goal as a painter, in my opinion, is to make large work, to make a heroic scale, to kind of participate in the lineage of painting, which is to create grand narratives or allegories or large scale work that is, that kind of encompasses the viewer, how do we best do that? And to provide an experience for the audience, we experiment with different materials. So vinyl flooring is a paper backing. You can make it archival by using red disc and glue, just like it would do traditional painters, or using gesso, kilzol as a modern equivalent of something you can use to seal that. And by doing that, you kind of experiment and say, well, you know, how do I, you know, can I paint on top of it? Can I draw on top of it? And sometimes it works, and sometimes it utterly fails. And so there are plenty of times where materials did not work, and vinyl flooring is just tough enough, being someone who kind of grew up in building stuff, I'm like, well, I know that's tough. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, hopefully I can definitely, you know, wear and tear on would be negligible. Mm-hmm. So.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Jessica.
So I got my bachelor's degree at Wayne State, and then in my last semester I took a leaving class, and that completely changed my trajectory going forward. So I pursued a master's degree in fibers at Wayne State as well, studying under the same professor and advisor, who is Heather McCauley. She's really amazing, highly recommend it. And my work, I guess, is, I'd say, I think it all derives from personal narratives. So something that happens, some material in my life informs what I'm doing, and then it becomes really cyclical. There's something about the process that grounds me in my body, and I think that that's part of why I like to make, is because it's this thing that does something that nothing else does for me. So I guess that is my very unrehearsed little about me portion of this talk.
And then your materials are always, do they always come from nature, inspired by nature? I mean, with this piece that you have some rocks that you're moving, so is nature always in your work?
I don't know if it always is, but it is definitely informed by it in some aspect, I'd say. But this, these three pieces specifically, yeah.
I'm Judith Feist. I received my bachelor's of fine art from Northwestern University in Fargo. Moved here in 2015. Both my undergrad and master's, I focused in printmaking. Although, like, probably my second year of grad school, it started shifting more towards object making and more three-dimensional pieces. I have to admit, like, the more I think about the work I've been making, so my work here are the little artifacts that are in the smaller room. I guess I'm a really sentimental person. Which is ironic because I also don't necessarily keep a lot of things. So the artifacts basically kind of started off as ways of showing communication. back to my like not throwing things away or throwing things away. In terms of my work, I don't really throw things away. I save them and try to rework them. And a lot of that has to do with basically the idea of how in certain situations we try to like fix or mend or alter ourselves to like fit into those situations, if that makes sense. Like basically just trying to fit in to a situation. And kind of like the relief you have when you no longer have to do that in a situation or a relationship, and in a way how kind of difficult that is to do because you're so used to trying to change yourself to like fit in and make other people happy, that once you're in a situation where you don't have to do that any longer, it's almost a different kind of stress, if that makes sense. But so the artifacts that I have, basically the installation is always changing. It's never installed the same way, mainly because the environment's never the same. A lot of times the pieces will be changing themselves. And also to be quite honest, I don't want to have to sit there and like document exactly how those pieces are installed every single time and try to figure out how I would reinstall them exactly the same way, but in a different situation. Like even hypothetically, like if I took them from that small room and put them in a large room, it's not going to be the same because it's a different environment. So right now a lot of my work is actually dealing with like mending and fixing and repair, both like in terms of like through personal experience, but also in like a utilitarian concept of just like trying to not throw things away and without like going way too deep into it, just because of like I think kind of the stress that a lot of people in society are having right now of like not having the money to afford new things all the time, or like the sentimentality of like having something that's passed down to you and wanting to hold on to that and keep it for a really long time so you can possibly pass it down to someone else.
What do you think? Do you think it's important that like the conversation between the viewer and your work, like do you think how important is it that they get it right away, or do you feel like when you're looking at something, is it important to you that they get it right away? You know, because for certain things, like for your piece, Jessica, you know, how important is it to you, you know, to that conversation? You know, like, here's a question.
I guess for me, it's
because some are going to be very personal, you know? Mm-hmm. Kyle, your art like, seems very personal to me when I look at it, especially that red flag one. You know, like that conversation, that seems like a very deep thought, you know? I almost think of like William Blake.
You're on the tip of the thought, isn't there?
Yeah, I'm the tip of the thought, for sure. So, when we talk about any particular subject, there's always, I think, there's always a difficulty conveying a message. Mm-hmm. And you know, the personal relationship, there's a relationship that you kind of enter into, whether it's wanted or not, that when you make work, you make work for a public, and you want it to be accessible. I think we had great professors that kind of instilled that, I think. And you want some kind of common ground. And so something I think can be personal to you that you are investigating, I think no matter what you do, the author has some kind of connection to the subject. And ought to, if you're going to have any kind of relationship with the viewer, you can't really make work that. You can certainly make work that you are not interested in, but I think that doesn't convey well. And I wouldn't know how to make work that I didn't feel passionate about some kind of subject that I was investigating to bring about some kind of conversation or question. So, you know, my work centers around kind of skepticism and questioning belief structures and what we deem as, you know, natural, supernatural. And so for me, it is a deep question about kind of why we explore these things, why we hold certain beliefs, and I wasn't, I think, really engaged in that conversation, to pose a question to somebody who approaches the work, I really want someone to try to enter in that. Whether they come to a conclusion, a particular conclusion is not what I'm looking for, but rather to question perhaps a viewpoint or a stance that they may hold, because that's, you know, the entire foundation of skepticism is, you know, to try to believe as many true things as possible and as least false things as possible. So,
I guess the entry point for me is it's not like an immediate thing. I like the idea of using familiar, whether it's like materials or forms or like introducing my body. It's like we all have a body, so that's really familiar. I think that's like a good entry point. But I guess for me, I'm more interested in the poetry that happens when I'm making, because I don't know what it's all going to be, and I think that it happens as I go, and I think that it happens as more work builds, like, upon a body of work, that this thing that happened or came before it is becomes larger and makes more sense, right? So just building imagery. And I like the idea that there's like room for imaginings. I don't necessarily set out to do that, but I leave the space for that, for somebody who might be looking at what the work is.
What about you, too? Because your work is also very personal, I believe. Now they're like these like coveted objects.
I have to admit, I'm a weirdo that will sit there and like hide around the corner and like watch how people interact with the work.
Yeah, you are.
Because I really enjoy that. Like, I really enjoy when I can tell someone's, like, this is in, it's like masochistic, but like I really kind of enjoy when I watch someone interact with my work and I can tell they're a little uneasy. Like, I kind of want to know why they're uneasy. And, but like, at the same time, yeah, it also makes me really happy when people sit there and like, so there's pieces in that room that are, like, different materials that are different than beeswax. And beeswax feels amazing. Like, it's super warm, it's welcoming. But, like, the pieces are also really creepy. Like, they look like some sort of skin, not on purpose, but, like, they kind of look like a skin. So I think people will either, like, react to them, like, really warmly because they'll sit there and actually, like, take the time to interact with them to where they, like, get really close to it and they can smell the beeswax and they're like, oh, this is familiar, I know what this is. Or they're just completely disgusted by it, but or a little bit of both, like something I really interact with it. But I think it's the type of thing where, like, I mean, you can't really sit there and like necessarily do something or like make work that everyone's gonna react in the exact same way. Like, that's just impossible. But like, I really wish that there was some way that I could be like a little and like watch how every person interacts with my work and like try to like ask questions or like without being too daunting, just kind of be like I remember a couple people told me like during a thesis exhibition that like they started crying when they saw my work and they were like, I don't know why, but there was just this, like, it was kind of overwhelming because there was all this stuff, but like when you stare at one thing, like your peripheral will immediately start kind of like focusing on either like pieces of the same color or the same shape or some sort of similarity, and so they're like, yeah, then I started getting distracted by like, oh, I'm looking at this red thing, and now because I'm focusing on it, like within my peripheral, I start seeing all the other red objects that are on this wall, and now I'm distracted by those. But I think there's also this like familiarity of like some of the materials, because like we all wear clothes. Like, a lot of people have had parents or grandparents that, like, mended their clothes or fixed their clothes. Or you had clothes handed down to you from, like, siblings or cousins or, like, even your parents. Like, I had a shirt that my mom gave me, and it, like, still breaks my heart when I think about it because it was so destroyed and annihilated by the time I actually had to throw it away. Because it was, like, 40 years old, and, like, I fixed it as much as I could, and it was, you know, without, like, jumping too far off. It's also the idea of, like, how much can you fix something before it literally turns into a new thing? Like, it's no longer the shirt for my mom, now it's my shirt that I fixed like 50 times while I was in my 20s because I didn't want to get rid of it. wish that there was some way that I could just be like, I don't know, maybe I'll do this the next time I install this work, and I'll have like some sort of comment box where it's just like, what was your first instinctual thought when you walked in here, and why, and like what questions you have about the work, and like I know you told us after the reception that like, oh, you guys ever want to come in and like do a workshop or something, like I totally want to come in
yeah.
on like a day and just
yeah.
sit here for uh-huh. the day and just be like, can't talk to you about any of the rest of these words, but I can sure answer any questions you have about mine and like start conversations that way.
Change the work since you don't have that anymore, and how do you maintain that, whether it's inspiration or just motivation even, you know, to be around other artists, because when you're in an academic setting, it's built in, so you have that, and when you're out, you're just, it's up to you, right, to continue that. So what do you guys do to continue that?
Opportunities to like present work, like pitch it for shows, people see it, things lead to other opportunities. That's been really helpful. And just like getting feedback on the work or opportunities that don't, you know, you gotta go after it. That's
yeah,
what I've done.
Yeah,
you really gotta get after it. So that's one. And then, you know, anybody who's around that I see who I know is interested, I'll show them what I'm doing.
Any serious practice, whether you be a doctor or a plumber or anything, or an artist, I think you should be genuinely, you've got to be genuinely interested in the subject matter. And then more specifically, something that you are interested in investigating, to uncover. I mean, we all kind of seek answers. We're pattern-seeking mammals. We love figuring that kind of stuff out.
Problem solving.
Yeah, problem solving. So the way that I look at it might be very different, but mine has always been kind of a process of problems.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I love the tactileness of paint. I love the lineage of paint. I love painting. So when I, you know, don't work on, let's say, more conceptual work, I want to make still forms. I want to paint because I'm interested in the practice and trade of painting. You know, and how to become a better painter. So now that does that kind of augment my practice when I don't feel like painting something that's conceptual or asking questions. Or posing a question, like, well, I'll just paint, and the act of painting is enough. Something that I was told by one of my profs during grad school, Mel Rosas, who's a phenomenal painter,
yeah.
mind blowing, and one of the people I really wanted to learn under, and he told me something very profound, which was, you have to love painting to be a painter.
Mm-hmm.
You have to love the exploration of paint, and what paint does, and how it combines, how you make color.
Mm-hmm.
That's something that has helped me profoundly, is just loving paint.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you have the passion, or you have the inclination to really get involved in paint, people can also enter into that space and say, wow, that person took a lot of time.
Mm-hmm.
Because you're being considerate of that other person's time, where they enter into a space and look at your work. If it's just a still life, it's still shows, you know, there's a passion and there's a love for the work or the working man. So that's what they help me, you know, be that is I get to teach painting, I get to teach people how to paint, so I get to continually try to better myself,
mm-hmm.
putting myself in a space where I'm like, I not only will critique my work, but I want to get to critique my work.
Mm-hmm.
You know, hey, if I make a mistake, what, you know, I get to tell you, hey, we don't want to make mistakes painting. Never going to make a masterpiece every time you do.
Mm-hmm.
And so that really helped me at a profound able to be in that space and get that kind of interaction.
I can't really know how to say this, but social media. Mm-hmm. As much as I absolutely hate it, it's also insanely helpful,
right?
Especially when, I mean, like one of the main pitfalls is that like you're seeing it on a small screen. Even if you see it on a computer, like you're not going to get like the full effect. But it's a great way of just communicating with other people within your field or like peers that you've known for a while but just don't live here. And I mean, like whether it's Instagram or like there are a bunch of groups that I belong to on Facebook that range from like really specific printmaking processes all the way to like critical craft theory, where you can sit there and it's super welcoming. Like you can sit there and post an image on one of these groups and just kind of like, hey everybody, hey all like 10,000 of you, I'm working on this thing and I like need some feedback. You know, here's the image. Like I'm sorry, this isn't like exactly how I want it to be viewed, but like I really like some feedback. And yeah, it can range from like one or two people just kind of being like, oh, that's cool, to like honestly someone you've always admired somehow jumping into the conversation and being like, oh, I think this is really fantastic that you're using these materials together. And then it's like, in a way, it's kind of this like really great uplifting moment because this like person whose work you've always admired is now talking about your work and you're like, oh, I have this opportunity to now pick someone's brain. So I think social media has helped a lot just in trying to like communicate your thoughts and get your imagery and your ideas out there. Because honestly, like it's really tough being out of school now and like do I want to sit there and like pester my cohorts who, you know, like we're all busy with our lives and try to sit there and be like, hey, we should all get together and have like a critique. It's like, hey Kyle, you want to bring your like slopping wet paintings 10 miles over my apartment so we can all look at them? Or like, Jessica, what do you need so we can like set up the video you're working on now?
And like
as awesome as it sounds, like it's not super feasible to do, which is I think the most frustrating thing about being out of school now. And like not being in a situation similar to like the Russell, where it's like super communal and you can literally just like walk down the hall and like, you know, hey, is anyone like working today? Can I like maybe shoot some ideas back and forth? So I think social media,
it's
a great tool, awful as it is, like can be used for really fantastic things.
How important is place, like you being a Wayne State grad, you're in the CAS cohort, or you're in this place, such a creative place. Has that influenced you guys at all, like where, you know, being here in Detroit, or here in CAS cohort, or the town, or whatever, how has that influenced you a lot, or opened up anything, you know?
So I have to admit, so I moved here from like North Dakota, and the 3 years that I was in grad school, and I will openly admit that like I haven't been nearly as good about being like as social or as like going out as much as I did when I was in grad school, because I also like I didn't know anyone here. So I was going to every single reception, artist talk, presentation, whatever was happening, and like even if it was way out in Cranbrook, like I'm trying to communicate with classmates and be like, hey, this artist whose work I actually really dig is like doing a presentation at Cranbrook, and does anyone want to go? And I have to admit, like the art community here is really like, in a way, it's fantastic, like really open. In terms of like if you're willing to put the energy in to like actually because like most art communities, they're also very tight knit, and a lot of times art communities are a little hesitant about letting new people in. If that makes sense. So I admit, I mean, I personally, since moving here, I've made a lot of really good connections, a lot of good friends in the art community here, which is really nice. And it wasn't nearly as hard as I was expecting it to be, but yeah, part of that actually happening, it was a little nerve-wracking.
And it's helpful when you have a network, like when you stay in school.
Yeah,
yeah.
I think building community anywhere you go is super important. We all kind of seek that out, and social media, obviously, I think complicates that, but also opens it up, and it's a very kind of terrifying existence that sometimes we live in. We live in probably the most open global community that we can possibly imagine in my existence so far, where you're able to communicate, like Judith said, with somebody who may be halfway across the globe and been working in Europe, and get a opinion, and you can probably garner a response. And that's something that's really quite unique. And so social media also opens up gateways for us as creators to communicate, create community there. Audiences play a big part. You know, sometimes your work is not fit for a particular audience. And so being able to put it on a digital platform allows more people to see it. But you also need a solid foundation of the community where you're at. And it's important to interact as much as you feel comfortable with in that community. And it can help you with feedback. So it is important, depending on what your ability is with interacting with a particular community.
I don't know I can't say whether or not like I would be making the same work if I was in another place. So I feel like place and where you are is important.
Mm-hmm.
It's like a lot of my work has been influenced just by growing up in the lakes area and like being surrounded by water and like realizing that we have something really special here in like this part of the country and this part of the world, and like what does that mean, and are we sort of like going to be responsible for that, or like what's happening here?
That's a great point.
But if I was in some other place, I don't know if I could make work or using the same materials, obviously, like this is dune grass root and the dune grass from Lake Michigan, so I can't say that would have ever happened. But like my rock collection, my stone collection, if I had moved across the country to go to grad school, this piece, the video piece, I don't think would have happened. So I think place is really important.
What do you want people to take away from your work, like after the experience? Is there anything that you hope that they feel this, or is that just boring?
That's always a tough one.
Right.
That's a good question. You guys want to tackle that?
I mean, I think in just like a general. Maybe like the work that I have on display now, I don't know, maybe take away from it that like, I don't know, maybe you, like as like hokey as it sounds, like, oh, maybe you should call that relative you had already like 4 years ago. Or like maybe you should forgive that person that, you know, you have a grudge with. Or maybe not, and maybe completely like wash your hands of that person from your life. Or just kind of go over and think about like the idea of like trying to fix or repair yourself so you fit into a situation. Like, why are you doing that?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, maybe be a little bit more, I don't want to say like be more critical of ourselves because no one needs that, but like, yeah, just kind of think about like why we hold on to certain things. Like my partner and I, over the last few months, I've been having lots of conversations about like sentimentality and like things that we conversations about like things you keep and why, and yeah, it's just kind of like the idea of like sort of hoarding because you're gonna use it later, but like it's not hoarding because it's not 5,000 newspapers, it's like 5,000 pieces of fabric that you can't get rid of. But yeah, just kind of, I don't know, hopefully, maybe not even hopefully, but it would be great if like people interacted with that installation and like had one thought of like, oh, I should call my dad because I haven't talked to him in a while, or like I should maybe go through my closet and get rid of the clothes I have only 10 years and donate them, or yeah, something like that, like those things.
Should I? I was just commenting off of your first thoughts, like just thinking about the. Reflecting.
Yeah.
So it's
the connection.
Yeah, I mean it's not immediate, but maybe like a couple days or weeks or whatever, and then you know, pick up a stone in a parking lot or something, and you're just like, oh yeah, this thing, that thing, and like with poetry and these simple materials or moments or whatever. And for me, it's too like the reciprocity of those things, of like the, our actions, our bodies, our relationship to the environment. Because I think that what we do and like its alteration of whatever it is we're doing that to also has an influence on us. And that's kind of where I'm at. But those are my hopes. That's like what I'm thinking about when I'm making it. But even just a little something that will stick.
I'm a person who loves people who question things.
Right.
I mean, it is probably the foundation of what I enjoy the most is when someone can look at work and they question a particular subset of belief or a particular thing that they're thinking about.
Mm-hmm.
Opening a dialogue with someone who teaches, that is my greatest passion. I mean, it goes part and parcel with me as a painter. Want people to have discussions. Discourse is one of the greatest tools that we have, especially in today's very kind of sometimes diametric environment that we have. We don't use enough tools of discussion and putting aside bias and trying to reach some kind of not capital T truth but lower T truth,
right.
Some kind of objective conversation. And so someone can come into a space and question or have a dialogue with that person afterward. That's what I'm talking about. I mean, you know, someone having a reaction is great, but someone having a meaningful conversation, that is really more inspiring to me and something that continues to drive me to make work. If I can do that or facilitate that in some way, whether it's directed at me or directed between two people when they're at home, That is something really profound and special. We do as human beings, and that's what I really, really want people to do. They may not. It's up to them.
I'm gonna go way back to just came to my head right now. But how did you guys come to value art like early on? I know like early on with my exposure to it. Like how did you get to understand this is like meaningful and start to identify with being an artist, because you work with young people, I work with young people, and when you experience them, when you see them being so young and maybe playing with the idea or art in general, you know, they don't identify as being an artist yet, or they're just kind of understanding that they're good at something. Like how do you as artists help people just in general value art? Like what ideally, like what, how would you like it to be? I know that's like a many part question, but if you can come up with something with that, you know? Just valuing art, or how did you become somebody that values it?
I think I was fortunate in that, like growing up when my parents were together, our garage was like, half the garage was like a workspace. It was like out there who would be helping me out. You know, like me pull the nails or like stuff like that. And like when I was in like middle school and high school, like my mom went back to school to finish her bachelor's degree. And like my mom has a bachelor's degrees in geology and ceramics. And so like when we were done with school, oddly enough, like the school we attended was right across the street from the university, so we could literally just walk to the university and like sit in the ceramic studio and watch her throw. Like, you know, when you're like 12 years old, it's super fascinating. Mm-hmm. And yeah, but like you just kind of grew up with it everywhere. Like it wasn't a, yeah, I don't know. I mean, I'm sure my dad like would never consider anything he did like art per se, but like, you know, it was the idea of like working with your hands, and like we had a garden too, so like we were always outside and we helped our mom organize the garden. And yeah, it's just growing up with two parents that made things. It was always super interesting. Yeah.
There's nothing you can do wrong, right? It's just like this open thing, right? You're free to do it. It's your imagination, like go crazy. What do you have going on in there? And then you can communicate it in any way you want that isn't words. And I remember like when I was a young person, I loved doing that. I'm like, I'm putting these acorns and these twigs and those leaves and this brew and this is gonna be magic. I'm not sure what this paint's gonna do, but like that's really special suddenly. And like, but that, I think that informs like art making, right? This idea that, oh, you can do anything you want with those materials and it makes sense to you. Like, why is it magic? It's like, oh, because you're choosing it to be magic. And I think that that's pretty cool.
But so you were able to get to that point right away, were you? Because some people don't get that. Like young people, like they think, art is just painting. You paint, not about the idea, not about, you know, all these other. So that's like their first connotation to art. Like, oh, you're painting. So how did you get to that point? Like the, you know, feeling free to work with different mediums with you know, twigs and things like that.
I honestly don't know. I had a really rad elementary school art teacher, Mrs. George. She had this huge red afro. She was awesome and so nurturing, and brought in different kinds of materials. So it wasn't just paint. She would have like twigs and feathers and weird stuff that we would put together. And like one project I remember in particular was Mother Nature, right? Like making Mother Nature, right? Clay or bells or feathers or leaves or whatever you want and make this thing. And
that early exposure to that freedom, right? Just like,
yeah, and this idea that nothing you do is wrong. Because I remember like during this same period, and those early moments for kids are so influential in realizing, just when we're reading about early childhood development, is that like I am just like, later in the first grade, second grade, third grade, I was really struggling to read. And then my third grade teacher was like, you can't read. And I was like, I'm so wrong. But I needed glasses. I couldn't see, so I couldn't read. And it was just like, it opened up the world for me, but I kept feeling like I couldn't do that thing. But for art, it was like never a problem. Like this was, you can do whatever you want here. And it being, you know, you can bring in like sort of conceptual stuff or like intellectualize the thing the later you go, but it's also cool if it's totally visual. Mm-hmm. You know, I think there's something to be said about like putting forth the effort to make something beautiful in the world when there's like chaos around you, and like that's enough. That's enough reason to be making. Mm-hmm. You know, if you want to get into like the politics of art or whatever, which I don't. Okay, same way.
Yeah, I mean, I think a common thread that we all share is, you know, having a supportive community. I had incredible parents. I mean, I had parents who, you know, saw something that I could do and then encouraged that in a reasonable fashion, although I didn't always obey some of the rules of school, like don't extremely important. If you have someone who supports that, even if it's a teacher, it's fundamentally changes, you know, the accessibility to, oh, I can do this, I can work with this. I had, you know, both my parents, my lovely mother was in the crowd, and my father, both were hardworking people, still are, work with their hands, you know, Midwestern people who really work with themselves to the bone. And I was very much instilled as, like, if you make something, if you put effort into it, you can make something work. So when it comes to, like, art, it's like, you know, if you're going to do it, you better do it to the fullest extent. Don't half it. You know, make it, and, you know, really try to accomplish that for yourself. And that was even true, you know, when I first, you know, wanted to go to art school. It was very much, well, if you're going to do it, you better do it to the best that you can. And I think that's really important to me. I needed that kind of structure, that kind of resistance. I didn't necessarily get, like, total creative freedom. I was always encouraged, but, you know, there's a good amount of resistance to, like, okay, if you're going to do it, like, how are you going to do it? And so I've taken that into, you know, my own practice and looking like, it's how am I going to do this painting? How am I going to do it? And, like, let's try to figure out how I'm going to do it so it's, you know, the best that it can. And then, you know, critique it and hate it afterwards.
So I feel like over the last year I've had this conversation like 80 times. You don't need a master's. But at the same time, you do kind of need a master's. Like, it depends on what you want to do. It depends on how you want to go about your work. Because, like, I mean, honestly, I use getting a master's to get out of North Dakota. I was like, oh, a master program in Detroit, I'm going to move. I'm going to take advantage of this, I'm going to move, I'm going to have all these things at my fingertips, and I'm going to, like, because you don't have that. Like, unless you somehow have the means, it's insanely difficult to make your work the way you actually want to. If that makes any sense. Like, I have formal training as a printmaker. Like, if I wanted to, like, actually make prints the way I wanted to, I would have to purchase, like, a $30,000 press. I can't do that. It's also really heavy, and they're hard to move. Like, it's not...
How big is your apartment again?
Right? Yeah. And so, like, if you end up going to school, like, you like, have that at your fingertips. Like, you also have the communal aspect, which is really amazing and really difficult to get outside of academia. I mean, honestly, like, the whole argument of, like, having a degree versus not having a degree can go on forever. I mean, some people don't need it. And, like, super kudos if you don't need that. Or, like, there's also the argument of, like, not going to, like, a traditional university and, like, studying a trade. Which, like, quite honestly, still doesn't have the same respect as having, like, a bachelor's or master's degree. So, yeah, it's the type of thing where, like, you know what? One piece of advice, if you're going to get your master's, go somewhere that's going to pay for it.
Yeah.
Flat out. Go somewhere that's going to pay for it. Go somewhere that's going to pay you to get it. And, like, take advantage of everything they have there. Like, take classes. Like I was really, really interested in, so, like, my mom also studied jewelry. So, like, I've always had this fascination with, like, tiny metal things. And, like, in undergrad, we did not have any of that at the school I was at. seriously go somewhere that they're going to pay for all of it. But like at the same time, if you for some reason also have like this opportunity to be in like a communal art space where you have access to like the machines you might need or like the facilities you might need, and you're simply just paying rent to that, then stick with that, because like you still have this communal aspect where you can communicate with people who are also like possibly working in your field. Yeah, it's the type of thing where like it goes back and forth, and like it's kind of frustrating trying to sit there and like in a way defend the fact that like you have a master's degree, or that like you have to defend that you chose not to get a master's degree, and that like one is better than the other because like you're super pretentious if you went and like got your master's degree. And it's like, well, you're not, but like it's also unfortunately looked at as like you're not as this kind of conversation can go on for like ever.
Can I spring off of that?
Spring off.
I just want to say, like, no matter what you decide, it's like the opportunities aren't just going to be like,
you have to work for
sprinkled
it.
Into your hand. Yeah. So, like, if like putting together an exhibition or like networking, right? Sure, like different schools will have like kind of souped up networks and like create more opportunities than others do, but generally, like, that's all on you to do the work.
Right. Yeah, because honestly, it's work. You, like, exhibition, like, artist talks that happen at, you know, private schools, they're still free. Like, they're still free to the public. Like the DIA, I still can't go over the DIA is free.
Yeah.
Like, the DIA is free if you live here. And all the artist talks that happen there are free if you live here. Like, if you don't go to those, that's on you. Like, if you sit there and you're like, oh, I don't have any opportunities presented to me. Yeah, you do. Like, I seriously still cannot get over how, like, the now 5 years that I've lived here, like, the artists that have come here and have given free lectures and how minimal some of those crowds were. Like, I still can't get over that Ursula von Reinsgard has, like, a piece over at CCS, and she, like, spoke at the DIA. Like, there's so many opportunities, and it is. Like, you have to take advantage of them. Like, they're basically presented to you. You just have to go do them. And it doesn't matter if you're in school or not in school. Like, it is, like, all available to you.
Research.
Yeah.
Research. I mean, my question, I would have questions back to you as kind of as an instructor, as this is how I help students, is understand why you want it. Why do you want the master's degree? This is true of any degree that you get, especially now because the cost is high. This is true of anybody who wants to go to college. Why do you want to go? Is that a good enough reason? If it is, great. But like Jessica and Judith have said, want that, you have to seek out opportunities that will not land in your life, especially for a master's degree. I was always told, apply for 15, hope to hear back from 5, get in 1. Because that's really what happens. And so, really pick and choose, if you're going to get a master's, where do you want to study? If you have the ability to go to that place, study it where you're going to go. Look at faculty work. Look at the student work. Is it just super didactic? Meaning that whatever comes out of there, just like a factory, every person looks like the instructors.
Mm-hmm.
That's really important. You know, because if you come out looking like your instructors were, that's not going to help you.
Right.
You have to market yourself, and that's with or without a degree. You have to make yourself the most marketable professional you can. Laura Coleman is a great example of that. She is someone who hustles and hustles and hustles when we were in grad school, and is incredible. And she's someone that you can talk to just at Wayne State. And talking to your former faculty about, you know, do you need that or don't you? But ultimately, it's why do you, you know, what is the perception? Do you need that? Is that something that is being kind of pushed upon you and is needed? Or is, you know, or is it just that? Is it just being pushed upon you and what you think? Their community is alive. And we've talked about that briefly. The community is a ton. There are a community that benefits them, profits them, and that they can make a living at, and they cultivate that, and they don't need a master's degree. Mm-hmm. It's also like, what do you want to do with that master's degree? If you're a fine art major, and I tell people this all the time, if you're a fine art major, you better really know that fine art is not a bountiful field full of profit. It's just not. Sometimes it is, and sometimes it is nothing but, you know, dead props. You have to be aware that not every year is going to make profit, and so it's going to be difficult. And getting residencies or doing these things is not always free. Sometimes you have to pay to play. So there are a lot of things that you have to take into account, and whether or not the burden of a master's degree is good or bad is something so profoundly personal that is, I think it's hard for each one of us to be able to say yes, like affirm it in the positive, like absolutely. I think we all had great experiences. We were lucky to have the cohort we did. But at no point would I ever tell someone, you have to get a master's degree or you're never going to get it. That's just absurd, because there are plenty of examples in any magazine you pull forward,
right,
plenty of people who are successful. Right. And measuring success, I think, is something we do a poor job of doing in society. Your measure of success is not garnered by other people. If you sell 2 paintings a year, and that is defined as something that is successful and brings you well-being, you can do that. But it does not mean that you needed a master's degree to achieve that goal, right? It just doesn't. Do I think it's a great experience? I can't deny that I had a great experience. Does it have downsides? I think we would all agree it has downsides. But it does not at all bring you more worth or less worth. It just depends on what you want to do. If you're going to teach, it definitely makes a difference.
Yeah.
Okay, if you're teaching like at a university, that is by and far something that is important. But if that's not what your goal is, again, it's all about the utility. What do you need?
Right, I'm perfect.